ബഹുമാനപ്പെട്ട കേരള ഗവർണർ ശ്രീ ആരിഫ് മുഹമ്മദ് ഖാൻജി, കേരള ഉന്നത വിദ്യാഭ്യാസ മന്ത്രി ഡോക്ടർ കെ ടി ജലീൽ, പാർലമെന്റ് അംഗം ശ്രീ ഇ ടി മുഹമ്മദ് ബഷീർ, നിയമസഭാംഗം ശ്രീ കെ കെ അബീദ് ഹുസൈൻ തങ്കൾ, പാർലമെന്റ് അംഗം ശ്രീ വഹാബ്, ആര്യ വൈദ്യശാലയുടെ മാനേജിംഗ് ട്രസ്റ്റി ഡോക്ടർ പി കെ വാരിയർ, ആര്യ വൈദ്യശാലയുടെ മുഖ്യ വൈദ്യൻ ട്രസ്റ്റി വിമായ മുഖ്യ വൈദ്യൻ ട്രസ്റ്റി ഡോക്ടർ പി എം വാരിയർ, പ്രിയ മിത്രങ്ങളെ, സഹോദര സഹോദരന്മാരെ, നിങ്ങളെല്ലാവർക്കും വണക്കം എന്ന നമസ്കാരം. കേരളത്തിൽ പ്രത്യേകിച്ച് കൊട്ടക്കലിൽ എത്തിച്ചേരാൻ കഴിഞ്ഞിടത്തിൽ ഏറെ സന്തോഷമുണ്ട്. ഇന്ന് ഏറെ സവിശേഷമായ ഒരു ദിവസമാണ്. ഇന്ന് നമ്മൾ വൈദ്യരത്ന പി എസ് വാരിയറുടെ 100-ാം പിറന്നാൾ ആഘോഷിക്കുകയാണ്. ഈ അവസരത്തിൽ നിങ്ങൾക്കും എല്ലാവർക്കും എൻ്റെ ആശംസകൾ നേരുന്നു. ഐ വിഷ് ഐ കുഡ് സ്പീക്ക് ഇൻ the beautiful language Malayala, but I can't do it also, so I have to speak in English. Brothers and sisters, we have all assembled here today on this pious occasion of remember the son of this great country, Sri Variyari, for the contribution he has made. I am very happy to be part of this celebration. When the organizers came and approached me, I readily agreed, because it is the duty of the government and the people and the present generation to recall the memory and the great service done by the great sons of this country. That has been our tradition also. I am particularly happy that my visit to Arya Vaidyashala Kottakkal is on very important occasion. Today we are celebrating the 150th birth anniversary of Vaidyaratnam PS Varier, a great visionary who brought about a renaissance of Ayurveda over the course of the last century. As all of you know, the long years of foreign domination, colonial rule, sought to make the country poorer materially and spiritually. However, the hard toil of several national heroes led to rediscovering the real India in all its splendid glory. I position P.S. Varier in the category of Indian Renaissance leaders who drew heavily upon both the Oriental and the accidental treasure troves of wisdom. His karma mandala, all of us know, was primarily the organizing, updating and contemporizing of the traditional Indian healthcare science of Ayurveda. Let me state here with conviction that he excelled in his mission like no one else did. On this occasion, I salute the memory of this great son of this great country for his contribution in the field of medicine. Through Vaidyaratnam P.S. Varier was an ardent follower of Indian traditions. He was not satisfied by merely dwelling on past glories and had set his vision on the future. His greatest achievement, I would think, was the fineness with which he incorporated the principles and methods of modern knowledge into the traditional science of Ayurveda. This was done without compromising on the basic essentialities of Ayurveda. The Honorable Governor, who is a scholar, he has rightly explained in detail. So I am not going into that. Sri Varier was also a successful institution builder. The 117-year-old Ayurveda Vaidyasala, 100-year-old Ayurveda College, 87-year-old Viswambara Temple, 85-year-old Hero Garden, Herb Garden of AVS, and the 80-year-old Kathaikali Academy. Here are living monuments of his institution building efforts. He considered it as his mission to give quality, affordable health care to those who could not afford it. The charitable hospital set up by, run by him 95 years ago is an eloquent testimony to his philanthropy. I must also compliment the 98-year-old Dr. P.K. Varier, who has nurtured and expanded this charitable organization as a managing trustee for the last 66 years. 98 years young man is there in front of us. The lifestyle is very important. One of the reasons for present diseases, particularly of the non-communicable diseases, is change in the lifestyle and also food habits. So each one of us must emulate such people. Is a living example of following Indian ancient traditional lifestyle and discipline. He is healthy. I had an occasion to meet him some time back and I came here. At that time I was in politics. Now I am retired from politics, but not tired from public life. That's why I am here. So I had an occasion to meet him, just to greet him, that's all. He is doing a great service, continuing the legacy of the great son of this great country. I strongly believe that India has the capability to become the wellness capital of the world. We have the capacity to become the wellness capital of the world. It is home to centuries-old traditional systems of medicine and wellness practices that not only foster physical health, but also mental and spiritual well-being. That is more important. From ancient times, India had a very systematic, scientific, rational approach to the treatment of diseases. The Atharva Veda is a treasure trove of knowledge and wisdom in the field of medicine. It is lauded as the earliest source of medical information in India. Ayurveda has been regarded as a Upaveda or subtext of the Atharvana Veda. Its history can be traced back to the 6th century BC. The foundations of Ayurveda were laid by ancient schools of Hindu philosophical teachings, Vaisheshika, and the school of logic named as Nyaya. The Charaka Samhita, the Sushruta Samhita, and the Ashtanga Hridaya are the other texts that contain a wealth of knowledge about Ayurveda. The mantras in Atharva Veda contain a wealth of information regarding herbs, metals, medicines, diseases, and treatments. They speak of the astounding properties and powers that plants possess to cure diseases. The therapeutic principles of Ayurveda focus on prakriti and tridoshas. These principles profound that every individual has his unique constitution and responds differently to treatment and medication. In Ayurveda, it is believed that a perfect balance between the nature elements and the tridoshas of the human body should be maintained for a healthy state of living. The practice of Ayurveda is based on a very sound knowledge base, which is documented in the hundreds of classical treatises written in the classical language of Sanskrit as well as in several other Indian languages. It has an uninterrupted history of providing primary and even tertiary healthcare services to vast population of India during the past several centuries. I personally feel that there is every need for the youngsters who want to excel in public life to read, understand Sanskrit also. Some time back I have been to Germany. The Germany universities, they are doing research on Vedas. They are having Sanskrit as a subject. But here in India, we try to raise doubts about Sanskrit. It's really unfortunate. And also, I shall tell you on this occasion, there is no need to have any reservation about any language. Every language is good. The children must be allowed to learn as many languages as possible. That's why in the recent aftermath of some controversy that is being made about language, I said, I would like to repeat, no imposition and no opposition to any language. Neither you should impose nor you oppose. Try to learn as many languages possible. Learning Sanskrit, learning Hindi, learning Urdu, learning even Arabic, learning French, Russian, and learning other brother and sister Indian languages. That is the need of the hour. Every language has got something special in it. So we should not have any reservation at all. But basically, I must tell you, the education must be in the mother tongue. Everybody must read in mother tongue only, in the beginning. In the beginning, the education has to be in the mother tongue. That's my firm conviction out of the experience I gained in public life over the years. Every child must remember five things. One, must remember mother forever because she has given you the beautiful birth. Mother includes, of course, father also. Woman, W-O-M-A-N, man is there in every woman. Second, every child must remember the native place. जो स्थान ने आपको जन्म दिया उसको कभी भी भूलना नहीं चाहिए जिंदगी भर याद रखना चाहिए एंड इवन इफ यू बिकम समथिंग बिग इन फ्यूचर इवन इफ यू वांट टू गो अब्रॉड गो लैंड एंड रिटर्न टू सर्व द योर नेटिव प्लेस दैट शुड बी द मोटो थर्ड थिंग इज एवरीबॉडी शुड रीड लैंड प्रमोट Practice, propagate mother tongue. The language that has come from mother's womb, you should never forget it because bhasha aur bhavana ek saath chalta hai. You have to understand that. You'll be able to articulate better in your mother tongue rather than other language. That's why I say mother tongue is like your eyesight. Other language is like your spectacles. Think about it, you will understand. The children should be taught in Malayalam in the beginning. Later you can go to other languages also. I am not against any other language. I am not against even English also. Learn, no problem. But first learn your mother tongue, which is the basic thing. And fourth is, remember your motherland. Work for the unity and integrity, safety and security of the country. Attack to Kottak, Kanyakumari to Kashmir, irrespective of caste, creed, sex, religion and region. India is one nation. We should all remember that we are one nation. Even if you are in Kerala or Kashmir, what is happening in Kashmir is a matter of concern for Kerala. What has happened in Kerala floods is a matter of concern for the entire country. That attitude we must develop. And then the next one is Guru. The Guru who taught you lessons, Jnan Dene Wale Guru, ko hamesha yaad rakhna chahiye. You should remember forever Guru who has given you the knowledge. People may say, sir, now net has come, internet has come, Google has come. Google is very important, I do agree. But Google can never replace Guru. Even if there is some repair in the net, you have to call the Guru again. So please remember these five things in life. That's what I tell all the younger generation across the country. My dear friends, in spite of the knowledge being available, it's not being properly patronized. Ayurveda enjoyed the patronage of a number of rulers in ancient India. The Mauryan state is said to have given Ayurveda an institutional base initiated by the exigence of trade, commerce and agriculture. In spite of non-supportive political environment created by foreign rulers, Ayurveda still survived and thrived today. Ayurveda is recognized globally as a Indian healthcare science with time-tested healing and wellness capabilities. It is not just a system of medicine, it is a philosophy of life. One has to understand this. It pursues humans as an integral part of nature. It entails a holistic way of life where individuals are in harmony with themselves and with the world that has surrounded them. Recently, I have been to Baltic countries, Latvia, Lithuania, and Estonia. Their people are discussing about Ayurveda. Their people are discussing about yoga. They were all telling us, sir, we like India. Someone told me in an informal manner, he said. I said, why? He said, sir, we love India because of three C's. He said, first C means culture. Second C, cuisine. Third C, cinema. He said in his own way. So Indian culture, Indian tradition, Indian medicine, Indian cuisine is popular world over. We here in India must take advantage of the initiative taken by the government as well as supported by organizations like this Arya Vaidya Shala. We must promote Ayurveda more and more in our life because it is easy, comparatively, it is affordable. The Shanti Mantra from the Brodaranyaka Upanishad exhorts, Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinaha, Sarve Santu Niramaya, meaning may all be happy, may all be free from disease. Ayurveda has now evolved as an effective healthcare system based on observations, empiricism and intuitive logic. I understand that during its evolution, during the past several centuries, it has assimilated useful inputs from parallel streams of knowledge and wisdom. It never remained insulated from diverse sciences. Its operational modality is what has been proclaimed by Vedas. Anobhadra kratavo yantu visvataha, meaning let noble thoughts enter from everywhere. Interestingly, just like many other oriental bodies of knowledge, Ayurveda has also evolved and developed many regional traditions added to its versatility. We must safeguard and promote this tradition of meaningful assimilation of ideas. Ancient systems of medicine using herbs and plants exist all over the globe. There should be a regular exchange of information between nations to further strengthen healing protocols based on natural remedies. This dialogue between natural healing practices of nations should be constantly nurtured so that knowledge does not stagnate and innovation happens constantly. However, any protocol or practice must be evidence-based. You must get information. You must know the best practices across the globe and you must have that information, because information with confirmation is more than an ammunition. So you must be always open to get information which has got confirmation. That is the need of the hour. Today, Ayurveda is increasingly being recognized, especially for its time-tested capabilities in dealing with non-communicable diseases. Musculoskeletal disorders, degenerative and lifestyle ailments, and pre- and postnatal care. India is now witnessing a disturbing trend of increasing incidence of lifestyle diseases such as diabetic, hypertension, even cancer. There is an urgent need to shift our focus from the treatment of these diseases to their prevention and general wellness. Ayurvedic practices and wellness solutions coupled with yoga and other forms of physical exercise can go a long way in preventing and controlling these lifestyle related illness. As a matter of fact, there is a need to integrate and harmonize traditional systems like Ayurveda with a modern allopathic system for enhancing the efficacy of treatments. The holistic and comprehensive approach adopted in Ayurveda could play an important role in treating chronic and lifestyle diseases. I am told that the institutions like Arya Vaidyasala are evolving a new therapeutic model to deal with the ailments of modern times like cancer, motor neuron diseases and autism. I must also refer to government initiative in this regard, where it is education, drug manufacturing, marketing, clinical institutions or pharmacovigilance, there are strict government regulations. Drug manufacturers need government license and GMP approval from drug licensing authority. Hospital can opt for National Accreditation Board for hospital accreditation. I am told that the Ayurvedic Pharmacopoeia Committee of India has brought out several technical monographs. There is a dedicated Ministry of Ayush and a Department of Ayush for promotion of traditional systems of Indian medicine. All of you are aware, thousands of public wellness centers have been established across the country with participation of Ayush Department, and many more are being set up. As the governor was cautioning us, these wellness centers are promotion of tourism. We must see to it that people who are well trained and knowledgeable are used, and we should not be based on what you call it as a promotion to marketing and advertisement and all. Nowadays we see lot of attractive advertisement, etc. We must see to it that people with original qualification are only allowed to run these institutions. New arenas of science such as Ayurgenomics that bridge the gap between genomics and Ayurveda, serving as an aid in understanding of inter-individual differences in response to therapies, are coming up. We must make use of latest technologies in the field of molecular biology, DNA profiling to learn more about plants and their properties. Exploration for new knowledge must happen constantly. All the new knowledge acquired must also be diligently documented so that it is transferred to the next generation. I am happy to refer here to the support of the government in this matter. The Central Council for Research in Ayurvedic Science and its different centers are undertaking extensive research activities. More recently, a task force in Ayurveda biology has been set up under the Department of Science and Technology to extend support to national research institutions and Ayurvedic institutions to strengthen the fundamental research in Ayurveda. I am happy to note that several research papers have been published in peer-reviewed international journals like Nature and PLOS One on Ayurvedic concepts like Prakriti and Rasayana. Nature is a natural healer. Several plants found in nature have some medicinal value. India is a treasure trove of botanical wealth. Exploration, identification, collection, documentation and conservation of medicinal plants should be accorded highest priority by everyone concerned with the study and promotion of Ayurveda. I note with appreciation that Ayurveda Vaidyasala, Arya Vaidyasala has been partnered with modern institutions like IIT, BARC, BHU for undertaking research. The ultimate aim of research, science and technology is to make the common man life more comfortable, to make the people happy. That is the purpose of research. So we must proceed in that direction and make life of the people more comfortable. All research must lead to evidence-based improvement in treatment protocols and help in producing medicines of excellent quality so that India becomes a thriving center for natural healing and wellness in the world. Before concluding, I must pay my tributes to Vaidyaratnam PS Varier. PS Varier was an exceptional person, an effective clinician, with a unique healing touch, an academician come education per excellence, a benevolent entrepreneur, a philanthropist, a man of letters, a promoter of fine arts, and above all, a representative of Indian Renaissance. As the Arya Vaidyasala embarks upon a series of academic, social, and public functions in the coming months as part of the 150th birth anniversary celebration of the illustrious PS Varier, I wish Arya Vaidyasala and its management team and all the staff members, students who work under the leadership and guidance of Dr. P.K. Varia, a very bright future in the coming years. My dear friends, brothers and sisters, India was known as Vishwaguru once upon a time. Students from across the globe, they used to come and study here in Ananda and then Takshashila, Vikramashila. Lot of people used to come. That was the knowledge that's available. That even now, that tradition must be continued. We must involve more and more in innovation, in research, and see to it that we come out with solutions to the present day problems, and that too in the health sector. As I was explaining to you, because of lifestyle changes, because of change of food habits, these non-communicable diseases are increasing day by day. We must come out with solutions. But along with that, we must all, in our personal life, try to maintain fitness. The Prime Minister has started a campaign called as Fitness India, or the earlier campaign of yoga, or Swachha Bharat, or per drop per crop, or tree plantation, or now giving up plastic use. All these are not political programs. These are all programs for the health of the nation, which will lead to wealth of the nation. If you have health, then you will get wealth. If you are healthy, you will become wealthy. If you are wealthy, there is no guarantee that you will become healthy. Keeping that in mind, we must all motivate our youngsters to do some physical activity, physical fitness. Some amount of physical fitness exercise is very much needed for all the children. Parents should take note of the prevailing situation of lifestyle changes and persuade the children, and education institutions also must focus more on sports, so that they get competitive spirit, they get team spirit, and they also develop physically their personality. And added to that, food habits also. Indian food, our traditional food, the time tested, thousands of years of our civilization, our forefathers have given us beautiful food according to season. According to season, we must continue that habits. We should not be carried away by Western propaganda or the brand making or the advertisement by using icons and all. The children are being influenced. When you have such great qualities of food, that too, different qualities across the country. I go around across the country. I take food in different parts of the country. How beautiful, how tasty. You have no parallel in the entire world. Even today, our food is catching up, our cuisine is catching up across the globe. So that being the case, because it is tested, it is prepared as per the season, it is prescribed as per the season and as per the reason. But unfortunately, the present food habits of some of the children who are trying to follow the Western food, fast food, and now they call it as instant food. I would like to caution the people, instant food means constant disease. This has to be understood by one and all. How can the food be instant? Food has to be cooked properly, then only it has to be eaten. So the instant food do not add anything good to us. You have to understand, this pizza, this burger, this all these names that are given, they are little fascinating, but they are not useful at all. I don't know what is their value in their respective countries because of their weather conditions, their seasons and all. But here in India, this food is not going to help us. And already reports are coming about the lack of deficiency of vitamins. We have to take care to see that we eat proper food, which has got proteinous value, rather than going for junk food and being carried away by the names at all. We see in the restaurants also, they put the names, attractive names. Chicken 65. The boy's age is not even 25. And he wants to eat 65. So that he can also become 65 at the earliest. I am not against any other food. I am not prescribing any food code also. But we must eat food which is prepared according to seasons. Yeah, that will take care of your health. So lifestyle changes, doing some amount of physical activity, and then the following proper food habits is also equally important. Ayurveda, if you follow Ayurveda, they will give you the proper advice. Because Ayurveda, body, mind, and what is required has been studied and also being prescribed according to the system and all. Keeping that in mind, we must promote more and more indigenous medical systems, encourage them also, and then move on, because we have a bright future. 65% of the Indian generation, they are below 35 years. We have a demographic dividend. There's a lot of expectation from India. The way people are responding to India, you have seen the other day, even in America, in Houston, how people are responding, how India is being recognized and respected. If you improve your health, and if you people, youngsters, if you improve your knowledge, acquire more skills, we will be respected much more, and we will be honored everywhere, and India can become a strong, stable, prosperous India. That is the way forward. I am very happy here today that Arya Vaidyashala will remain a name that is synonymous with the authentic Ayurveda. I wish you all the best. Thank you very much. Namaskar. Jai Hind.